I am honored to be invited by the team at Jobs for Her. They are doing wonderful work in this area, and we need more of that force to, you know, join hands and take the work forward. So I am very honored to be invited by them to talk to you about something that is extremely pertinent today: emotional wellness, and in the perspective of emotional wellness, work-life balance. So yes, I am thrilled. I welcome you to the next half an hour or so of spending time together. I hope that is going to be a very good use of your time. So we'll spend the next half an hour or so talking about emotional wellness, work-life balance, and we would also look at it from a couple of different perspectives, if I may call it so. And more importantly, what is our role in that whole scenario? How can we be emotionally well as individuals? How we can protect our own space, how we can thrive, how we can flourish, how we can flow? And at the same time, how do we try to nurture and nourish emotional wellness in our various roles that we play in our lives? As parents, as, you know, as people living in homes, in the society, in the community, how we can help to parent in a more conscious way, in a more emotionally rich manner? And then what we can do as fellow beings, like as colleagues, as friends, as bystanders. I think that is a very understated topic, because out of, you know, one person who does something and one person who is the victim, I think there are 98 of us who are bystanders, and we don't often talk about that. So I would want to, you know, touch on that aspect of emotional health. And the very way in which we shape up our own lives, our workplaces, our homes, our entire sense of being, you know, how we ensure emotional safety, emotional wellness in how we find ourselves, how we create. They say that how we live our day decides how we live our lives. And oftentimes we while away our days in hope of something good happening to us in our lives someday. But essentially, it is the here and now that matters the most, as many of us know by now, right? So we are going to talk about all of that. To briefly introduce myself to those of you who are joining now, I'm an author, a columnist, an orator, and a thought leader. I have spoken a few times at TEDx and a few other very important platforms where I was honored and humbled to be invited to share my thoughts. I speak a lot on gender sensitivity, on emotional wellness. I am about to be the founder of Lighthouse. That's going to be my enterprise. I'm putting the work all together. The website will be up very soon. But for now, you can follow me on LinkedIn or on Facebook, facebook.com/lighthouse website. The work I will do at Lighthouse is to work to make more storytellers and change makers and thought leaders, and to help skill build in terms of, you know, spoken and written words, to be able to express ourselves, to be able to create, to be able to articulate our thoughts, and to be able to move the force with us. Because I feel that, you know, we were grown up to be, you know, to be working under a boss. And for a while we did talk about, you know, the future belongs to the entrepreneurs. But now perhaps the time has come when we realize that the world, perhaps the future, belongs to storytellers and change makers. A lot of the things that we have made as humankind needs a revisit, needs an overhaul, and we need some serious thinkers. We need to join forces, we need collaborations. Exactly the kind of work that Jobs for Her is doing. So many other people are doing such good work, and we need to all join forces and work towards it. And that's my, you know, humble endeavor at Lighthouse. So yeah. So much for my introduction and what we are going to talk about. Let us delve right in. Emotional wellness. Before that, let us take a quick look at how we think of us and our lives. You know, very often, and this is borrowing from maybe old scriptures or ancient ways of talking, we can perhaps look at our lives in three circles. One is, of course, ourselves. The intrapersonal, the inside, our mindsets, how we thought, how we think, how we thought, how we were brought up, the conditioning, the nurture, the nature, the perspectives. So the first circle we are going to talk about is the self. The second circle we are going to talk about is the people. People who surround us in our immediate circle. It could be our family, it could be our children, it could be our spouses, it could be our colleagues, our next door neighbors, our parents. So essentially people who are our kin. And it's very important that we talk about them when we talk about emotional wellness, because we are but social creatures, and we are greater than the sum of us, and we are perhaps nothing without those sum total of people around us. And finally, thirdly, I would want to touch upon the third circle, which is the social, the community, the global. The way the world functions, and the way that reflects on us, the way we give and take with, you know, the way we transact with the world, the way we try to influence the world, the way we take, receive from the world. So yeah, self, circle and society. So allow me to take up each of these circles in turn. And just as it always should, we should start from the near and go to the far. And so let me first talk about self, us. Now, obviously, talking about self is endless. We know that we, you know, perhaps hold the entire universe in ourselves. But philosophy aside, and you know, and the expanse of the very possibility and prospect and the potential of one human life, which is enormous. You know, I often talk about Mary Oliver's line. You know, what is it you want to do with your one wild and precious life? So one life is a big opportunity, and one life can be a big mistake if we do not handle it well. I do not want to delve too much into the philosophy and the spirituality of one life, because that in itself can be an endless conversation, but I want to talk at least a few aspects of a day-to-day practical ways in which we can take care of our emotional well-being. I think at this point I should also clarify, as should any of us talking about this subject, that you know, clinical mental health condition is quite a different thing. I am not going to touch upon that. It is really a case-to-case basis. It is tackled best by your visit to a professional. I am in no position, I am not qualified, and I am not equipped to be able to talk to you out of a clinical medical condition, and I'm not going to attempt that at all. What I'm going to talk about is more of our day-to-day well-being, feeling well, doing well, and thriving better. You know, the common struggles, the personal and the political. So first I want to talk to you about something that hits us the most when we feel emotionally not so well. I think the feeling that hits us most around that time is that we are alone in it. There is this huge shrouding aloneness that clouds our process of thought. And, you know, wherever we shift our eyes, our observations only try to agree to and kind of ascertain that understanding that we are perhaps the only one feeling this way. I mean, everyone on Facebook seem to be having a whale of a time, right? Cooking new dishes and traveling to new places, posting new film covers and listing out, you know, sari pictures and learning a new instrument. It often seems that we are perhaps the only one feeling down. And this is where I want to begin the, you know, very conversation. You are not alone. I am not alone. For a very long time, I too, you know, I felt severely badly that way, that maybe it's just me. And then the question comes, why me? Why am I so unfortunate? Why am I so unlucky? You know, why is it that I cannot be happy, and pushing myself to be happy doesn't work that way. And before that, I'm not alone in it. So aren't you? And I think more of us should try to wear that on our sleeves, that, you know, we do feel low from time to time. It is only normal, it is only human, and the more we try to hide it, I think we are failing, and we are letting down people around us who are also feeling that way, and they're feeling that we won't understand because we are happy, right? So yeah, I think you know that bit will always be there. We have to remind ourselves that there are so many things in which the way the world works today isn't quite ideal. It is in fact very unfair. As women, I hope I can safely say that it's a little more unfair. There is obviously the intersectionality of many kind of causes, many kind of reasons why people are prejudiced, etc., etc. So there can be many things, like people can be, it could be because of your race, because of your gender, because of your class, because of the bank balance. So those things apart, what is important to understand is that there are many things that are wrong in the society. It is not our cross to carry. We can offer only when our cups are full. We can offer to help others, but we also have to wear our own seatbelt first. We also have to know that while it is my duty to take care of my emotional health, the reason why I am feeling low, the reason why I am feeling left out, let down, is not my fault alone. It's not my shame, not my guilt, not my fault. And I should not allow it to weigh down on me that, oh my God, everyone else is so happy. Why am I feeling this way? We have to get beyond that feeling to begin with. That is where, you know, the inner work starts, to understand that we're all struggling. Let us hold hands and struggle together, and let us help each other. So yeah, stress, oftentimes we talk about workplace stresses, and today, since the topic is about work-life balance, stress is good to a certain extent. Stress is good because it gives us motivation, it puts us in a healthy competition, it tells us, you know, finish this thing, and there is a certain achievement at the end of it. So yes, to some extent there is an upward curve. Beyond that, it can be detrimental. Beyond that, it can burn us out. I have personally, been burnt out. I have been exhausted. I have had a total swerve in my career. I have been 12 years into a full-blown actuarial job, coming back. So I have seen that firsthand. I mean, that is all I can tell you. I mean, my personal story, you can read it up if you're curious. It's, I have been featured at a few coveted places for the kind of curve that my career took because of that. And I have been successfully, I feel very proud to say that, many of us, we don't know what we are capable of until we are pushed against the wall. So I did have a plan B reservoir inside us. I had no clue about, which only, could be drawn out of when I had lost my straight road. And I'm sure that there are many people out there who have, reinvented themselves in their careers. And but that apart, what can stress do? World Health Organization, more recently, they updated their ICD handbook to now list workplace burnout as a clinical condition. I mean, for a long time, we would just, say that, oh my God, no, that's nothing. It happens to everyone. But now we know that this is a clinical condition. This is, so severe that we hear all these news all around us. I mean, I'm sure the last 2 days have been terrible for many of us. The, what happened and what, it was a time for reflection, a time for deep introspection. So workplace stress, workplace bullying, workplace prejudice, being, let down, being let alone, being, that lacking sense of belonging, all of those are realities. And no surprises there, even though, each of us have different struggles, different challenges. Men are often said that, boys don't cry and there's a huge suppression of emotion. I feel that women also, are hugely disadvantaged in this scenario, and especially for women, I don't want to sound like, it's a competition of suffering, but for many of us who struggle to raise careers and children together, it has been a very rough journey, right? At workplaces, you have to pretend like you don't have a child, and back when you are back home, you have to pretend that you don't have a job. So there's a huge lot of pretense and, you know, priorities. What is your real priority? That gets kind of clobbered in the process, and it's very difficult. You cannot do justice to all the parts of yourself and to yourself, you know, as an individual. So what can we do, really? You know, some practical tips maybe. When I was really down, then I, you know, obviously I, perhaps like many of you, I did go to several, you know, places. I spoke to therapists, I read up a lot, I watched a lot, I, you know, whatever you do, try to climb out of that abyss. So now when I look back at my journey and everything that I read and learned, I think that I can safely divide the learnings into three stages. One, the first is the SOS, the first aid, you know, what you can immediately do on the days that you just cannot get yourself out of that darn bed. What do you do? So that is what I call first aid, or, you know, SOS. What comes handy to me, what I found useful, is one, to just move your body just a little bit. If you are lying down, just pull yourself and bring yourself to a sitting posture. If you are sitting down, you know, just stand up. If you can, you know, if you can do it, get up and fold something, you know, fold the bed sheet, fold a towel. If you don't have anything handy in front of you, just go to the wardrobe, pull out something, unfold it and fold it. Just move, you know, move your hands a little bit, move your body a little bit. I think, you know, that at time of you know, very, very, very acute blue, it comes handy. Just move yourself a little bit. If you can do that, take yourself to a shower if you're home. If you cannot afford to do that, if you're at your, you know, work desk and you are not really feeling up to it, at least, you know, drink a little few gulps of water. Water does somehow, I don't know what, water is quite magical. So yeah, and hold a pen between, you know, like just like this, you know, take a pen and just hold it in your jaws. What is very funny and very interesting is that, you know, oftentimes it's not easy to, you know, it's not easy to remember this, but the mind and body are related in very, very, very intrinsic ways. I mean, we are not taught this in school. I so wish that our future education system should try to talk about this more, the body wisdom. The way, you know, our mind affects our body, and if you're lazy, you lie down. The same way when you, you know, when you force yourself a smiling position, maybe, you know, something works inside. So yes, do that. One thing that I also do is I try to stay close to a pen and paper, or rather I keep a pen and a paper close to me. You know, one set of pen and paper next to my bed, one set of pen and paper next in my study, next to my laptop. So I do that because one thing I have seen work magic for me is to start saying that, you know, write down two questions. Number one, what am I worried about? And when I try to answer that, that, you know, I'm feeling blue, I'm just not feeling like anything. But when I have to push myself to give words, to give labels to that feeling, you know, what am I worried about? What exactly am I worried about? Be it anxiety, be it sadness, be it, you know, just exhaustion, whatever it is. When you put words to it, something happens. You know, the feeling maybe loses power. So your first question would be, what am I worried about? And your second question should be, what can I do about it? So if it is like, you know, I'm angry at something, what can I do about it? Avoid that person, not talk to that person, ignore, forgive, you know, throw something, hopefully, you know, unbreakable on the floor, do something. But what am I worried about? What can I do about it? Writing those two answers down does help to separate the subjective feeling from the objective, you know, analytic perspective, and it does help a lot. It has helped a lot. And again, the final question, if you can, you know, remember it at the time when you were really down, the final question would be, will it matter in 5 years? So at times, you know, one bad email, one bad whatever, one person snubbing you, one person saying something or not saying something, we lose perspective. We become suddenly very myopic. And if only we can remind ourselves to ask, will it matter in 5 years? You know, poof, it goes away. So try that out, and I hope that would be handy for you. The medium term, which I call, is more of, you know, practices that we can develop. And this is best done with, you know, at least for me, the way I do it is, some of these are personal, but some of these are, you know, if you can partner, if you have a little child at home and that child, you know, at times listens to you, like my child at times does occasionally. So it's a nice way of, you know, imbibing your work and life, parenting, etc. So one thing we often do is three good things. So every night before we fall asleep, we, you know, we count three good things. So much so that in front of my, you know, in my bedroom, in front of the bed on the wall, we co-sleep. Not the best thing to do, we do incidentally. So on the wall, it's written three good things so that we don't forget. So yeah. We quickly count three good things, and then very often it gets into a competition that she cannot copy mine, I cannot copy hers. And I, you know, the rule is that if you want to add something more over and above your three, then it has to be six. It has to be a multiple of three. So if I have four things to say, then I would have to find something to make it six. And that kind of pushes us to find more and more reasons to be grateful for. We very often forget, but at times we remember to also thank everything before we take our food. So we start with thanking the farmers who grew the food, to the fishermen who fished, to the cook who cooked, and to, you know, to the household help who washed the dishes, to the carpenter who built the dining table. And that also becomes a little bit of a competition and fun, that, you know, everything, what is everything? Once you start counting, you just cannot stop. You, and frankly, it's a moment of contemplation and reflection as to really, you know, there's so many people who are doing stuff so that I can even at this moment sit here and talk to you over the internet, right? I mean, it's quite I would say, yeah, a reality check in a very good way. So in terms of work life, specifically to talk about work, one thing that that is often advised, I am personally not very good at it, but I would pass on the advice as collected, is that especially because I'm an author and I write books, so very often my view is like, you know, my vision and my view is like the entire book. So this will what it will talk about, this is what it is going to be about, and it's so overwhelming and it's so long that you lose motivation. So very often people who are experts in you know, productivity and project management, they say that break your project up into manageable pieces and then break them further up into tasks so that you can finish one bit of it and give yourself a pat in the back that yes, you have done it. So you know, that very act of your to-do list or task list and checking that off, that gives you a sense of accomplishment, and it's very useful to have that as a daily dose rather than thinking in 6 months I will finish three chapters. Tried that, been in a limbo for forever. I think it is a good idea to try to force yourself to project manage before you execute the project. The same thing goes in terms of the reward and recognition. So you tell yourself that once I have finished that one chapter, I'll give myself a treat, I'll indulge myself. You can also try some things that I used to do when I was, you know, doing much worse. Now, thankfully, touch wood, I feel I'm more emotionally more resilient and more ready. But there was a time when I did, you know, take very, very, it may seem a little too, you know, practical, but it did help me to change the lights of my room into tube lights so that the room is brighter, because I had these fancy lampshades and the room always looked very dark towards the evening, and it somehow, you know, pulled me down somehow psychologically. Also, you know, I did indulge myself. I spent a little money in buying myself fancy candles and essential oils and, you know, those fragrant wax candles in glass jars and all. So small things, a nice notepad, a nice pen. As they say, it's very difficult, but many of us who remember falling in love, you know, yawns back when there were dinosaurs walking around us. So yeah, when you fall in love, the way you feel like doing something for your beloved, maybe, you know, around middle age, a time should come when we treat ourselves the same way, fall in love with us, or, you know, pamper us. So yeah, I mean, I think that is more medium term. If we can take some conscious steps in trying to do things that will make our every day a little more pleasurable, we have to do what we got to do, right? We'll come to that, what we got to do and what can be outsourced, and which we will come in the, you know, long term measures of handling emotional wellness. But in the medium term, at least we can help ourselves be pampered and indulged, and help ourselves with a little bit of reminder of things that we are grateful for. We have blessings to count only if we would look, you know, in the right way. So yeah. Finally, I come to the third part of our model of self. And by this third part, I must, you know, I must get a little philosophical. Excuse me for that. So I have personally been, I'm a bong, you know, brought up in Calcutta. As a bong, very often means to be brought up in a more communist mindset, and I am born to atheist parents, for which I'm very lucky. I consider myself very blessed for that. So there was very little stigma, prejudice, very few, you know, I do, you know, realize now how lucky it has been not to be brought up with a lot of, you know, prejudice. But it also means that I grew up realizing or being taught and conditioned that, you know, there is no higher force, you are you. Which is true. When I struggled with mental health, then after a point, after, you know, many months of analgesics and antidepressants and anti-anxiety and nerve relaxants, whatever, you know, that concoction, right, that plays havoc on your mind and body. So after a lot of that, a phase came when doctors told me that, you know, try out meditation. And I found it very difficult at the beginning, because everywhere I was looking, meditation seemed to equate religiousness, and spirituality and religiousness in my mind were, you know, till that point, it was not very clear, the difference between the two, which is why I kind of threw the bath water with the baby and I said, this is not for me. So yeah, I tried a few things, tried and came back. Very soon it would enter the chant of, you know, some kind of gods, and I would, you know, back off. Then I discovered Vipassana. Vipassana is, you know, a very atheist meditation kind of a thing where they, so yeah, you can find out more about it if you're interested, just Google Vipassana. So standing now today, as I talk to you, I have completed 5 courses of 10 days of silence each time. So 10 days of not talking to anybody, not looking anybody in the eye, not having any gesture, just eyes down, going inside, inside and inside. So that has changed me for life. I can safely say that meditation has been kind of, you know, it has been, it has opened up a new me that I didn't know existed. It has been very handy. If at all, you know, if you feel interested, you can try some kind of meditation, whatever works for you. But yes, I mean, mindfulness, meditation, these are now becoming mainstream. It is no longer just the possession of the monks or, you know, only few people, because we are now realizing that the average wellness level of people around us is so poor that it is, you know, mental health is not really only about people who are screaming or doing something that we call crazy. It is really now about each one of us. We need help to be able to make that, you know, better sense of our life and of our days, and meditation has been really rewarding for me. Also, a lot of books, a lot of films, I'm sure many of you would agree that they help to open perspectives. They help us to, you know, look at the same thing from alternate views. It's almost like looking at the, you know, prism. So You are just, you know, talking inside your own mind, but the moment you put yourself in your spouse's shoe or in your child's shoe, you realize that, you know, what it looks to have the same incident happen to them from a different character point of view. My life of an author has also helped me, because first time you jot down, you know, what you feel, and then you try to change hats and kind of, you know, see how the things are, how the plot, the story is from alternate characters. And I think that has reflected back on me as a person a lot, that act of writing novels. And again, you know, if you are interested, you can read up a little bit on, you know, positive psychology, the PERMA model. The PERMA model is, I recently just completed, you know, two courses in positive psychology and one more course on positive psychiatry, online, like, you know, 6 weeks course kind of a thing, each of them. So it essentially talks about how to do positive interventions in your life, how to have positive emotions, P for positive emotions, E for engagement, R for relationships, how to nurture relationships better, M for meaning, how to chase or, you know, try to have a meaning of life, a purpose, and then A for accomplishment, how to kind of, you know, give yourself the next thing to go to. And overall, I think, you know, a little bit of reading, a little bit of writing, creativity, perspectives, all of those things in the long run might be good ideas. It will help us, each one of us, to develop the muscles of emotional wellness. Because when we fall down and there is bleeding, we put a band-aid. But when we have to grow immunity, we have to really, you know, take long-term measures, like watch our food and do exercise. So, yeah. So much for what we can work on the self side of things. And I would want to, you know, repeat once more that as much as there is so many things that is wrong with the world, the way world functions, and we must talk about that, we must fix that, we must do everything in our power to be able to make the world a better place for the next generation to come, we must wear our own seat belt first. And what I told you in terms of doing immediate things, doing medium and long-term things, is really to be able to draw boundaries around yourself and to be able to help yourself become, you know, more emotionally ready and more emotionally resilient to be able to face the world. Yeah. Now let us change gears a little bit. I want to talk now about emotional culture at workplaces, because as much as you know, we take care of ourselves, if the world is so wrong, then we need to also talk about it. And we also need to see, because at times we suffer from a victimhood, that we are only the recipients in the world. So whatever is happening in the world, you know, we are at the receiving end, and we have to only, you know, wear our own seat belts and our own safety gears, and you know, stride through the path. But it is not so. We hold responsibilities at the workplaces. We have to be better to make life better for other people. And in the process, we will all be better off. When we talk about workplaces and professional roles, you know, one thing that I want to draw your attention to, and I offer as a starting point to think about, is, you know, for every generation, there is going to be a generation gap, right? As a generation, I think us, like, you know, our generation now, the way our parents saw the world, they made estimates and presumptions, and they brought us up in that way. So especially, you know, when I was speaking at my second TEDx this last year, November, I closed my address. I was speaking about gender sensitivity at workplaces, and I closed my address saying that we as women, our generation, we have been brought up by our parents to be ready for the workplace. Now it falls on us, this generation, to bring up the workplaces to be ready for women. I think now that I'm talking to you about emotional culture, the same can be said about emotional culture. Our parents, the way they saw the world, you know, they were industrial age workers, and they saw the world as we will all grow up to be able to go to the workplace and report to a boss and listen to them. And at their time, people used to work alongside machines, right? they saw it that way, that how we can learn to take instructions and follow them through and see to a completion of a project. Our education system, the entire academic model was based on IQ alone. There was no question of EQ, there was no question of body wisdom, there was no question of anything else but scores and marks and admissions and, you know, cracking the next job. We know better. Let us pride ourselves with that fact that we have learned a little better than that. We grew up and we entered the job, the workforce. We entered our jobs and soon enough we realized that there must be more to life. This isn't enough. This isn't quenching our thirst. And one practical aspect of that is that we are now knowledge workers. We are not industrial workers. We don't work alongside machines. We work with the machines. And I remember this quote by Chris Anderson, who's from TED. I love this line in his book where he says that in today's time and age, machines can really do most of the things that we used to do at times. So it can even do the most sophisticated and the most minute surgeries. And so in today's time and age, with so much of technological advance, we human beings, we are, the only way left to be human beings is to be human beings. The only way left to be human is to be human. To be able to put our feelings forward, to be able to embrace our mess of a human life. And unfortunately, till today, we are working with a lot of hangover from that industrial age. By that we mean that most of our work, deadlines, our targets, our goals, our KPIs, they are driven by a fear psychosis instead of love. Instead of collaboration, there is competition. A healthy competition is good for productiveness, but we are greater than the sum of our parts, and yet we are trying to kind of, elbow each other, and that culture is very much there. And maybe, I'm just making a presumptuous statement here, but allow me. Maybe in a country like India, it might be a little more so, because it all depends on scarcity versus abundance. And, we have been brought up with the belief that there are only so many jobs out there. There are only so much of resources out there, and we must, run and rush and reach and grab. So that mentality has stayed with us. Our academic careers, it has been based on how well we have finished our own answer scripts, instead of, trying to do something more collaboratively, if we had to make friends, we had to hush and talk and, hide from the teachers. So human bonding came much with a lower priority than, finishing our syllabus. So a lot of those things work. In 2016, Google undertook a study, which was called the Project Aristotle, where they tried to understand what makes teams great. And after a lot of analysis, they came to the conclusion that out of many factors, this is what makes teams great: psychological safety, the ability to be yourself, to be able to express, articulate without fear. And fear must win over love. And the way we operate at the workplaces or in our work lives, even if we are working from home these days in the lockdown, we can be defensive, we can be aggressive, or we can be conducive. And we should consciously watch out how we behave, how we hold space, how we help each other. And we can only lead and then, do unto others what you want others do unto you. If we keep emotional well-being at the core of our very reason of living, of acting and thinking and breathing, I think automatically we would also become better human beings who would make life easier for other people. Like, even if there is this cold customer call, that, ma'am, would you like a credit card? I definitely consider that a distraction. But instead of being rude to that, young girl, I don't know her story. I might as well just say, thank you very much. I don't need it anyway. I hope you are doing well. I hope you are safe in these trying times. You guys are still working under the lockdown. Strike that one or two lines of conversation. It won't harm anybody. So, we have to learn to be kind. it also helps to feel emotionally well, to be psychologically safe, like, to be able to articulate and express our thoughts, express our doubts, voice our opinions. And if I am coming across as non-threatening, somebody would perhaps listen to me more carefully than before. They would not feel insecure. And I think exchange of ideas is a major part of our productivity at work today. Ideas are the currency of this 21st century. And as individuals, if we do not put our perspectives on the table, I mean, just running those codes and generating those numbers and, hiding those errors in the reports and, shoving things under the carpet, I don't think we are getting paid for that. Sooner or later, we have to grow internally to be able to grow career-wise. And if we are emotionally stronger, we can voice our opinions, the error reporting goes up, accuracy goes up, performance grows up, learning and development goes up, process improvements, and that eventually leads to greater profits, greater ROI for the shareholders. So as individuals, as well as, in whatever managerial positions you are working in leadership positions, as many of you who's listening to me today might be in, it is very imperative that, we rise beyond what we learned all this time. We rise beyond that. We go beyond that. We push ourselves and we say that, yes, let us allow to make errors so that we can learn better. And not just that. Think of us as bystanders, as I was telling you a moment back. With one victim and one abuser, there are like 98 bystanders at the least. And all of these things, the last couple of years saw us through Me Too, saw us through racism. The just, last few weeks have been quite reflective in terms of all the prejudice that has come up, in terms of, work-life bully and every single thing. I'm not sure how many of us are over it. I still am, like, last 2 days, I have been, like, really kind of trying to process it emotionally. And, nepotism, unfair practices, racism, bullying, Me Too. I feel that now is a time when working well or scoring marks alone won't see us through. The boys' locker room and stuff like that. We have to stand the test of character. It is a good thing. It is a good thing. It may sound rough at the moment for, there might be many sides to it, but it is going to be a good thing. And when we have to pass the test of character, we better prepare to be ready emotionally and to be able to spot our own faults before, outside agencies come through and reveal and unfold, the real gaps that we tried to neglect when we were putting our eyes on the Sensex and on the ROI for the shareholders. So let us be a little more proactive in that area. Let us be emotionally well and psychologically safe as workplaces, so that we can test our own characters, we can grow our own characters before we are hit by a posh, we are hit by a Me Too, we are hit by a boys' locker room, we are hit by a George Floyd, or we are, let us do some serious reflection out there. And it starts with us, it ends with us. We are the society, we are the self, we are everybody. And workplace policies, I would not go more into that. That is really a very, long discussion, a separate session in its own right. But as leaders, there are a lot of things we need to do. We have to allow for mental health provisions in our, in our health provisions. So our insurance should stretch into mental health. I, as an employee, don't have to call up my boss and say I'm having temperature when I'm actually having an anxiety attack, or when I'm having a period cramp. So we have to open our minds and open our prejudices, and we have to have a meditation room next to the gym. We have to have our town halls where the leaders don't just talk about our quarterly, achievements, but also talks about failures. So it's a long discussion. This actually constitutes large parts of my workshop, so I'm trying to make a gist into a very short while. But we have to watch out, we have to hold space, especially for new mothers, for women, for new mothers, for mothers to be able to bring up children and careers together. There's so much work to do, and it is high time we look at that, because soon enough somebody else will look into it, and we won't like that. Finally, I would, I know I'm quite over time. I will quickly go through the last larger circle, We spoke about self, we spoke about workplaces. Now let us talk about what we can do as a society. As self, society, bystander, individual, professional, teacher, parents, you know. It might seem like they're the closest kin, but at the same time, how we bring up our children is really how we leave the world, you know, when we go. So it has a huge connotation. So a lot needs to change everywhere, starting from our education system, which should start talking about EQ, starting from the way we parent. We don't even talk about body wisdom, but we teach table manners to 3 years old. A lot of reflection to do there as parents. Small things like counting our blessings, three good things, acts of kindness, you know, asking each other, what is the three acts of kindness we did today? Challenging some of our own conditioning and presumptions. You know, we are all prejudiced. I mean, I think, you know, to be, I mean, parenting has been a great reckoning personally for me. I think, you know, it has only shown me a mirror, and I'm sure many of the parents will agree with me that it's very, you know, parenting kind of brings out everything that was so wrong, but you did so well so many days. So many other things, like, you know, understanding your own body, understanding your hormones, understanding, you know, reading more, learning more, holding space for others, and understanding that we feel more than we think. And we have to acknowledge and accept and be aware of that and work with it, and, you know, to redefine many of our ideas about success, about what is success, what is failure, to talk about food for the mind, as we talk about junk food for the body in terms of pizza. We have to talk about many other things. We have to watch out for the inadvertent messages, like, you know, pink for girls, blue for boys, boys' birthday buy a car, girls' birthday buy a doll. So many of the things. I mean, there's no end to how much we need to work on those areas. So yeah, I mean, these are large topics in their own rights. I actually do several weeks of training and master classes on this. I try to put them all in a gist. I want to end with one reflection that has really come to me more during this last few weeks of lockdown, that I do feel that the future is going to be very different than how we have seen our lives be all this time. And I have this very nudging hopefulness that the future is going to be feminine. It is perhaps going to stop us to smell the flowers. It will perhaps stop us to be more experiential than be more, you know, blind rats in a rat race on, you know. It's going to be less of a hustle and more of a reflection, and more of a, you know, we need to kind of re-engineer everything that we knew to be our human lives. There's a lot going on outside, perhaps bigger than what we can perceive. And just as I said, to, you know, quote Chris Anderson once more, the only way left to be human is to be human. And to be human is messy. I mean, our emotions. There is nothing called good or bad emotions. It's all useful. It's all a part of being human. It's messy, but it's so beautiful. It's so beautiful. If only we would allow ourselves to just, you know, to pause and understand, and to try to make the world a better place. And for us, for our children, for the world, for our colleagues. I mean, it really doesn't matter. Who cares? I mean, we don't even know who's now immune from this pandemic that's happening out there, but we have got three cars in our basement, and we now know suddenly, you know, the difference between what we need and what we want. And it's a huge time for us to introspect. I think the future is going to be feminine. The future is, it doesn't mean female. Feminine is not female. I mean, we are all androgynous, right? We have to watch out for our feelings, for our wisdom, more than our success. So yeah, I wanted to share with you quickly what my understanding is, in a humble way, of, you know, whatever I gathered from my, you know, whatever years of life. For those of you who have been patient and, you know, stayed with me through the time, I really thank you from the bottom of my heart. Once again, I'm, you know, to introduce myself to those of you who don't know me already. I'm Shinjini Sengupta. I'm an author and a columnist and an orator and a thought leader. have spoken on a couple of important platforms, a couple of times on TEDx and other places. I speak a lot on gender sensitivity, emotional wellness, and new age education. I am about to start my own enterprise called The Lighthouse, where I hope to be able to grow up more storytellers and change makers and thought leaders, because I feel that the future world will belong to storytellers and the thought leaders and change makers, and we need to make some serious changes. And I would try to help at the best of my capacity with giving them skills to articulate and express, to go inside and to bring outside the goodness of human life. And through written and spoken words, I'm a public speaker and an author, so I give trainings in these areas. And I would love you to follow me on my LinkedIn, on my Facebook page, which is facebook.com/lighthouse website. And thank you so very much. I do hope that this added value to your life. And if you liked it, do share the video. I also want to add, my answers to a couple of questions that were sent to me very kindly by the host team. And thank you so much, Jobs, for her to have invited me and given me this opportunity to bond with you. So I will take a couple of questions, and if there are any more questions, do feel free to leave them for me, and I promise that I will get back to you in, I will type out the answers to best of my ability. So yeah, question one from Tanya Chatterjee. Hi, I have been working from home for 3 months, and maintaining household chores while working has been a difficult task. How should I be emotionally fit to have a proper balance between these two? Thank you so much, Tanya, for asking that. I hope, I have by now spoken for a good 50 minutes on exactly that topic. I hope that has helped to answer a few of, a few that has given you a few ideas about what you can do to help yourself with, balancing your life. One more thing I could maybe add here is that very often we talk about work-life balance as if they are, two contesting areas in our life. And yes, we have been taught to look at it that way. However, two things. One, work and life are not the only two aspects of our life. There are many things. And work is a part of life, right? Life is the whole thing. And there is self, there is family, there is relationships, there is having fun, there is going to work, there is bank balance, there is job satisfaction. So there are many items, and not all of these are exclusive from each other. Of course, many of our jobs, especially the corporate jobs, which requires us to be 8 or 9 hours online into our job, which is different from our household chores. There is no way I would try to make you believe that there is an overlap between doing dishes and doing your phones. But somewhere our purpose, our value system, the kind of person we are, it carries over. If we can take time, maybe once a month or something like that, to be able to stop and pause and see how we are doing, and also kind of come to peace with the idea of, everyone has 24 hours a day. We all struggle with time. As much as I have tried spirituality, I could not get myself to think of the notion that time is abundant. I can think wealth is abundant. I have enough in my life. I can think love is abundant. But time has been scarce. It's a difficult thing to think of, that there is enough time for everything. But if only we could try to have reasonable goals for ourselves, that okay, I will do this and not get distracted. These are my distractions, write them down. So next time there is a distraction that comes up, I will ask myself, what could I do to handle it better, or can I outsource any of it? Now I know there's a lockdown, and it's like, many of us, we are not allowing, household staff to kind of, work with us, the way they were working before. So it's not easy to say outsource the distractions, but we have to work out a kind of a routine, a kind of activity list, a kind of coming to peace with this new normal. It's difficult, yeah. I hear you. It's difficult. It has been difficult for you. It has been difficult for me. Just try to not let it get emotionally disturbing for you. Whatever has to be done has to be done. Let us try to, you know, make it more analytic than emotional. Jigna Vikas Sharma asked, "Hi, most of the social media platforms and news channels are inciting negativity, which directly or indirectly affect the work. Should I avoid them for good mental health?" Jigna, lovely question. Yes, I think if you are talking about the media platform and news channels talking about COVID-19 or, you know, or these kind of, you know, whatever has been going on in the world in terms of the riots and in terms of, obviously, you know, the recent news of, you know, Sushant Singh Rajput, which frankly I haven't also processed to, you know, fully. So yeah, I mean, I, you know, we all have different coping mechanisms. If you think it will help you to avoid them altogether, do that by every means. You don't owe the world your presence in social media. Let's get it straight. You don't owe anybody anything. I mean, we often underestimate our own control over our time, and we overestimate how much we have to show up to the world. So by every means, feel free to do what works for you. For me, at times it helps me to go totally like on a hiatus. At times it helps me to kind of, you know, run those news channels and lash out at that bad news just to be able to cope, because I cannot cope, like it's too much for me to handle in my silence. So for a while I would watch that and then I would close it. It really depends on what your gut feeling is. I mean, just listen to yourself and do what helps you. But whatever it is, you know, keep an eye on your emotional wellness. That comes first. Put that at the top of every other possibility. Charita Reddy, hi, I am a final year student of engineering and doing my internship at an IT firm. Can being emotionally strong help me as an intern? And how can I get better at it? Yes, Charita, yes, yes, and yes, resounding yes. Emotionally well can, you know, emotional wellness and being emotionally well can help each one of us, even in our sleep. I mean, forget about the waking hours. Even in our sleep, it will help us to sleep better and not get nightmares. So there is no question about it. What can you do to get better at it? I think if you have watched this video, or if you're going to, you know, watch this video later on from the recording, it should be able to answer a few of those questions. You are a final year student of engineering and doing an internship at an IT firm. So, you know, I am conscious of two things. One, I'm, you know, excited about the phase of your life where you are standing today, just at the cusp of finishing your academic and going on to take the world. And that's such an exciting place to be in. I'm also conscious that if you are giving me that question now, the reality of today is so much different than maybe what you would have hoped it to be. I mean, we had this comfortable reality around us where people, you know, pass out of colleges and get placed and go ahead in their lives, and suddenly this time is upon us. And I cannot really tell you how much I mean it when I say that, you know, I feel you. It's, you know, it's humbling to think of where you are, and put emotional wellness at the top of it, please. You know, maybe in 5 years' time or 10 years' time, whatever gap arises out of the reality of this current moment, maybe that would even out. I mean, you have seen, I'm sure, we have all seen those messages on LinkedIn which says, you know, to the class of 2008, to the class of 2000. I mean, all the times when there has been some huge, you know, thing that has affected us career-wise, there has been, you know, they have done well over time. So I can only, you know, keep my fingers crossed for you. Do very well, and do very well emotionally. That's first. Neha Alva, hi. Many times my 12-year-old son has to suffer my anger because of the frustration of work. How should I be strong enough to maintain my emotions so as to have work-life balance? Hi, Neha. You are a senior to me in parenting, So yeah, I am humbled that I get that question to answer from you, though I would also say I'm not sure I'm competent enough, because a 12-year-old adolescent, I mean, I have parenting experience up to 9 years, let's say that. So yeah, I totally get it. I mean, parenting is far way tougher than what people make it look like, from, you know, what our parents made it look like to us. And yeah, parenting is tough. In terms of how to manage anger, if I can ask that more as a, you know, generic question, I think this is a good time to reflect on what Stephen Covey often, you know, said and wrote, that human has more freedom than what they know of, and the place of freedom lies, take this, you know, seriously and listen to this a little carefully. The place where the human has their degree of freedom lies between the trigger and the response. So the trigger that causes us to be angry and the response that we give, not the reaction but the response. I think meditation also does exactly the same. It teaches us to respond than react. If we can just, you know, be a little more mindful, and if we can make good use of that little space between trigger and response. One way, of course, is to go back to the tip I gave already, to keep a pen and paper handy, and every time you feel like, you know, that rage coming over you like a wave, answer that quick question: what am I afraid of? What am I angry about? Oftentimes when we write it down, it poof, vanishes. Even if it doesn't vanish, you know, so miraculously, it at least gives us perspective. Maybe we are overestimating, maybe we are kind of magnifying it. So yeah, it's kind of, you know, parenting is very hard, but at the same time, it's very hard on children. I think of my daughter also, when I'm very busy and I kind of shoo her away, you know, no, I'm busy now, and she has so much bubbling inside her, and she needs to say that then. And all we can do is, you know, parenting is hardly about so much about giving them food on time and giving them clean clothes to wear. It's so much emotional. And yeah, I mean, my heart goes out to you, and my heart also goes out to your 12-year-old and to my own 9-year-old and to myself and to each one of us who are parenting and trying to balance it all. It's very difficult to be fair to both, you know, both of us and our children. Natasha, I think. Hi, I have been working as a HR for the past 2 years, but now the work of HR is stressing me out. How should I tackle such situations to be motivated during work? Natasha, hi. Lovely question. That question can be addressed at various levels. And I think this is really a good time for you to look at it from a multiple, you know, multiple layer point of view. One, is it that your job, you know, work at the moment that's stressing you out, and you need a little bit of help with time management, project management, relationship management at work? Or is it that the very purpose and, you know, your value system, what you want out of life, what is your meaning and purpose, and what is your answer to big questions? What am I here for? You know, what is your, you know, what really drives you, and what you think will make good sense of your existence in this planet? Does that sink in with your career as an HR, and do you want to take this opportunity to reflect and, you know, see what you want to do and build skills? And it may sound dramatic, and I don't want to obviously advise anybody to kind of leave everything behind and, you know, take on a new road suddenly. There are, you know, huge risk factors and huge emotional you know, overhaul out of it. But yeah, I think you should maybe, you know, look at this question from two angles. One, do I need help with my day? Or do I need help with my life decisions? And give yourself time to ponder over those two questions. Maybe map your purpose, value system, map your strengths. That's a wonderful place to start with. I mean, as you can clearly see, I'm very talkative, right? And I think I would like to believe that I can articulate with words. And my job as an actuary, I worked for 12 years and studied and, you know, cracked very, very difficult exams for those of you know who's an actuary. So, you know, I'm an associate, qualified associate actuary. So my job at, you know, was only to talk to computers. And in my profession, there was absolutely no differentiator between two people, one who can speak and one who cannot speak, or one who can write, one who cannot write, like, you know, in language, in literal form. So, yeah, I mean, what happened, you know, is there was a mismatch of what was my innate strength and what was my academic degree and my career and my investment so far. So I think at times we need to ask these tough questions, depends on where we are, what our financial liabilities are, what our investments, what our risk-taking appetite is. And there are so many aspects to it, but I would really ask you to kind of go back to the whiteboard and do a little bit of a homework on that, and then, you know, maybe take advice from a few people who you trust who have done either this or that, and you might, you know, get a better feel around this big question. Tina Rebello, Tina, hi, to what extent should it be mandatory to check the emotional stability of a potential employee while recruiting him or her? Wow. Tina, thank you for that question. So, what is emotional stability, I wonder? If you mean to ask if you want to check on the emotional wellness or mental health of, you know, those are not interchangeable, I'm sorry, I'll take that back. If you wish to ask if you should check on the mental health of an employee, of a prospective employee, I would say as an employer or you know, on behalf of an employer, if you are working in the recruitment area, I would say it is important for us to hold space and be sensitive and be kind to all the people who are working with us. The question becomes a slightly gray when it comes to recruitment decisions, because as much as we talk about inclusion and diversity, the reality is that, yeah, we are recruiting the best candidate of all the people, and in terms of productivity and all, you know, it might not affect, it might affect, it really depends on what the job description is. It really depends on if it is a front facing, you know, or a back end job, or what exactly it is. So this is actually a pretty deeper question. I am sure that the recruitment policies in any good place would definitely bar somebody from using this as a place of discrimination. However, how to make best use of the strength of the candidate in which job opportunity, these are, you know, deeper discussions. It's not easy to give an answer to it in one line. Having said that, I would still say that we should open our arms. Yeah, we should be kind, we should open our arms. And if a person is already working with you, the only way we can help the world, ourselves, and that person is to imagine that we could be that person. Like, you know, there is no other. Whatever that any other person who I'm pitted against today is, tomorrow I could be that person. So, yeah, I think sensitivity is very important. However, in your exact position, what exactly the job description is, what exactly the, you know, the position of that person is, I mean, I think the answer would be a little subjective based on a few other factors. Anushka, you ask, hi, I work as a data analyst. My efficiency decreases when I'm working under pressure. I want to work efficiently regardless of the workload. How should I reach that level of emotional stability? Lovely question. Yeah, Anushka, I hear you. Stress is only good till an extent. Beyond that, it leads to exhaustion, panic, anxiety, and I think, you know, it often leads us to, like, say for example, at times, if I just think of a very casual example, at times when I'm writing or when I'm doing something, you know, any kind of thing that has a proper close and opening, I may eventually end up finishing that in 3 days. But if I have to constantly remind myself, oh my God, I have 72 hours to do it. Oh my God, I am, you know, 50 hours are already behind me. I have only 22 hours to left. Oh my God, will it happen? That causes a kind of strength that adds to the, you know, the stress of the real objective activity I have to do, right? I mean, I think the question is very real for many of us. when we have a deadline, we have that panic and anxiety. Project management, breaking up those projects into pieces and giving smaller deadlines to each of them. So this takes 1 hour and I will keep half an hour as buffer. So if there is a spillover, I target to do this much in the next 6 hours. But if I cannot do that, I will keep 2 hours as a buffer. So if we can just, you know, project manage better, I think our efficiency can be better. And more than our efficiency, our mental health condition can be better, which will help improve the efficiency. Orunabho, hi. Due to some family issues, I am unable to concentrate on my work and this lack of concentration is affecting me as a professional. How can I work on improving my emotional wellness? I hear you, Arunabho. We all have our ups and downs in our regular, you know, long-term employments. Unfortunately, as you know, as outside consultants working on short projects or as freelancers, we find that often the clients are quite insensitive to these things. Unfortunately, we should work on that area. However, if you are in a long-term, you know, job, like employment scenario, I think this kind of this is exactly the kind of thing that we mean when we talk about emotional wellness and psychological safety at work, that each of us, we should hold space for each other to be able to, you know, as managers, as colleagues, to be able to fill up for each other and to be able to let each other, you know, have these down times and up times. So I hope you find, you know, sensitivity in the people you work with. Try to have a good, you know, conversation with them. Try to make them see your reality and the, you know, the time when you feel better. Try to do that for somebody else proactively, so that the next time this comes around, you have set a precedence for yourself, and people can only be inspired and motivated to follow your footsteps. I hope that you have also set precedence in the past as you know, as a colleague. So I think there is, you know, at the moment it's really our luck how understanding our boss and colleagues are, and that's unfortunate because it should not depend on our luck. There should be a safety net around us emotionally. At the moment it is luck, but let us try to make it a practice for all of us. Gina Khurana. Hi, earlier my work hours used to be 8 hours, but because of work from home, my schedule has increased from 9 to into 9 to 10 hours, I think. The increase of work hours disrupt work-life balance. How should I cope with it? I think again, Gina, a lot of project management, a lot of, you know, one tip I can give is maybe, you know, over the next 3 days or so, just have a little, you know, A4 size paper next to your workplace and jot down the activities. Whatever it is, lunch took so much time, cooking took so much time, distractions were this. Each of the distractions, I mean, distraction cannot really be always counted in time. If there is a, you know, a doorbell or a phone call, even after you hang up or even after you answer the door, it takes a while for us to kind of, you know, come back to the flow of our work. So yeah, I think one is to create a, you know, kind of a logbook of that kind of thing over next 3 days or something, and see which are the leakage areas and work on that. Also, maybe, you know, the advice I gave on project management and time management, these are difficult times. I don't want to take away, you know, that from you. I mean, these are all very difficult times and it's not easy. And we also have to be at the top of our game because, you know, the employment conditions are also not looking very good. So we have to be, you know, be ready to prove we are up to it. So these are difficult times. I don't have a very, you know, clear answer to how exactly to cope with it, but I hope that my tips over this entire session and to, in answer to project management and preparing that logbook together, would give you, you know, some kind of a space to work emotionally better. And once we are emotionally, I mean, we at times also exaggerate, oh my god, what will happen if this doesn't happen. Putting it down in pen and paper helps us to navigate that a little more analytically. Yeah. So the final question from Alicia, how does meditation or other yoga practices help in maintaining emotional balance in stressful work conditions? Alicia, thank you for asking that. I hope I have already answered that. Meditation is not easy at the beginning. Don't, you know, I won't try to trick you into believing that you start it and suddenly you get, you know, all the benefits soon. It's like, you know, at Vipassana, like my teacher says, it's like watering a plant. So at the beginning, you have to just plant the sapling and pour water for many days and create a kind of niche around it and protect it. And only, you know, over time, it will grow into this, you know, this tree, which will give you shade and it will stay lifelong. So it's a, you know, it is not one of those SOS first aid measures, but if you can imbibe that in your life, I mean, I tell this from my personal experience, it has been life changing. It has been life changing. It has totally kind of, you know, lifted a kind of curtain from behind my eyes, and it has totally kind of knocked me open. I am very grateful for, you know, for meditation to have arrived in my life at all. I had no clue about it until I began my first session in 2016, when I went and just stayed there for 10 days in full silence, and I think I'm a different person now after it. Yep, so that is me talking and talking and talking forever. I hope this has been useful to you. I wish each one of you the very best. These are trying times. I feel that, you know, these times have a message for us. It is also a little bit all like labor pain, you know, a new life awaits for us. I mean, the other side of this would be a new life, a new normal, a new world, and we human beings will have to revisit a lot of things that we thought was true till now. It is a huge paradigm shift, no less. Take care of yourselves. Take very good care of your emotional health, because it is only through our mind's eyes that we navigate this world. And I would love to stay in touch with you. Do stay in touch with me through facebook.com/lighthouse website, or you can follow me on LinkedIn. I am Shinjini Sengupta. I am an author and a TEDx speaker and an orator and a thought leader. I speak and I work with, you know, master classes and workshops in the area of storytelling and change making and thought leadership, and I do believe that the future belongs to change makers and storytellers and thought leaders, and we, each one of us, should become our own person and tell our own stories very proudly. Irrespective of what work we do, what lives we lead, we still have stories to tell, and we can only leave our, you know, positive legacy through our stories and the changes. And I do hope that I have been helpful to you. Stay in touch. Take care. Bye-bye.